Hey guys, welcome back to the Pulling Curls podcast. Today on episode 120, we're talking about negotiating with terrorists. Kids. Negotiating with kids. Let's untangle it. And the curly head behind the Pulling Curls podcast, where we untangle pregnancy, parenting, home, and even travel. We know there's no right answer for every family, but hopefully we can spark some ideas that will work for yours. Life's tangled, just like my hair. Okay, guys, before we get started, remember you can subscribe. If you've listened to me a couple times and you're like, oh, our podcast is kind of fun, just jump into your favorite podcast player, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, jump in there, subscribe. Bonus, you can always leave a review while you're there too, and then the blessings from heaven will rain down on you and your kids will do exactly what you want, I'm pretty sure. Thanks. Okay, guys, today's guest is the brains behind the law firm Hashtag Legal. She does legal for small businesses, and she always talks on negotiation when we're at conferences, and she's actually my lawyer. I want to introduce today's guest. She's actually been on before, Jamie Lieberman. Are you overwhelmed by all there is to do around your house? As a new mom, I felt overwhelmed at every turn. Fortunately, I turned to systems to make a change. Whether it's mornings, dinner time, or even just to climb out of a pile of kids' clothes, my course, Family Routines, can save you. I hold your hand as we smooth out these rough patches, making every day easier so we can more easily handle when your preschooler tells you they can use their urine like a lightsaber. Parenting is always going to be a wild ride. Routines are just your seatbelt, and they can support you. Use coupon code UNTANGLED to save 15% at checkout. Link in the show notes. Hey, Jamie, welcome to the Pulling Curls podcast.
Thanks for having me.
It must be so fun to talk about parenting versus law. Which one's easier?
Oh my God, law. Come on. Parenting. Who says parenting's easy? Do you have anyone who's ever said that?
I guess people with nannies, maybe. Like,
I have a nanny.
No, like full-time nannies. Like,
she's
they don't.
Full-time.
No. She doesn't come on the weekends, does she?
No, she doesn't live with us.
No. I'm talking about people who basically just see their kids. Like the queen. The queen probably thinks parenting's easy, right?
That's fair. Yes, I would agree with that. She probably does think it's easy. She's wrong.
Okay, so Jamie is always who I look to for my negotiation tips. When I was thinking about quitting my job at the hospital, I was always going through Jamie's tips as I was talking to my manager. And I was like, don't be afraid to pause, because that's like my worst one. I hate it when it's just quiet in the room. And I just hear Jamie in the background say, don't be afraid of the pause. And I just sit there and be like, I'm going to wait for you to talk. I wish you the best.
I have that with my kids all the time, and they don't mind silence. So they'll just stare right back. I'm like, now we're just here for 10 minutes while we're staring at each other silently with like in each other's eyes.
That's so fun. Parenting's fun. Okay. All right. So what are your tips for negotiation? And by the way, if you are looking for business tips, Jamie's actually my lawyer. She did my trademark and my copyrights and other lawyery things. So if you're looking for a lawyer for your small business, Jamie's your gal. Her business is Hashtag Legal. But she also gives this talk at lots and lots of conferences. I think I've heard it twice.
I think you've probably heard it more than twice.
Maybe. Okay. What are your tips for negotiating?
Do you want my general tips?
Well, I think we take like the tips and just apply them, right?
I like that.
Children.
So
slash terrorists.
Yeah. I love that. So my first tip, you know, I have steps for negotiation, which I actually think could really work with kids as well, because your first step is actually strategizing. And this is where I think we go wrong as parents, right? We never strategize. We just like jump right in with the emotion of the negotiation, because often it happens on the fly. I mean, even this morning, my kids were ready 6 minutes prior to having to leave for school, and they have a new Lego set because it was just my older son's birthday and he got it for his birthday. And of course, what he wanted to do was open every single bag and dump all the Legos on the floor and then leave, because why wouldn't you do that? And so I'm in the moment with him. And instead of stepping back and strategizing and thinking to myself, like, how do I want to handle this? I was just like, no, get out of here. And then he started to negotiate. He's like, well, what if I just take the bags out of the box? What if I just open one bag? And what if I leave the bag so I could put the stuff back in the bag after I take it out of the bag? So I think strategizing is your first piece of advice.
Yeah, stepping back. I mean, the problem is it's a constant negotiation, right? When my kids are home, it's a constant negotiation, I feel like. Can I have more internet time? What time is my curfew? What time do I need to be home? Can I take 7 snacks in my lunch? Can I, you know?
Can I not have lunch and just have snacks?
That is lunch, Jamie.
For me, yeah. I mean, I feel a little hypocritical when I'm like, no, you can't eat Doritos for lunch. And I'm eating Doritos for lunch, but whatever. I'm a grown up.
That's right. You've already grown all your cells. They are still growing cells. So I think that's a good tip. In my logical parenting post, I have one that's like, don't be afraid. This is especially for teenagers. Don't be afraid to like step back and be like, I'm going to take some time to think about this. Because also I think that makes your kids like, oh boy.
I mean, going back to your idea of the power of the pause, I actually like saying to them, like, I need a minute, you know, I just need a moment for us to think about this. I mean, obviously with my example this morning, we had 6 minutes, so we didn't have a lot of time to pause and I had to, you know, just cut the negotiation, which was zero. But we did have, I try to, in that strategy, think to myself, you know, and I do this really in my framework, because in when you strategize in a business negotiation, or frankly, any negotiation, you're thinking like, what are my interests and what are their interests? And I think as parents, sometimes we forget that our kids have interests, right? They have opinions and feelings and they want things. And our instinct is just to be like, no, get out of here. You can't do that. That's crazy. But thinking about what their interest is, what does he want to do? I mean, he's super excited. This is a brand new 18 plus Lego set, no joke. And he wants to start doing it. So instead of just being a flat out no, put it away, it's like, how about we do it later? Or at this time you can do it. Or if you open it, we're going to do X, Y, and Z. So strategizing and thinking about like, what is he interested in? And what does he want? And what do I want? And how can we come together to make those things aligned as much as possible.
Or if you open those Legos before school, I will burn them in the fire pit.
That's also another less collaborative approach.
Kind of more like the queen.
Yeah, exactly. I'm sure she says the same thing. But no, I as a negotiator try to be much more collaborative. And so I have to remind myself that my kids are human. And just because they're kids doesn't mean that they don't have feelings and they don't have wants and needs and opinions. And sometimes their wants, needs, and opinions are really bad for them. So you have to take a hard line stance. But in this instance, for me, my interest here was I don't want to step on your Legos, or I don't want to have to be cleaning up your Legos at 8 o'clock at night. So I don't want them all over the floor because I know you only have 6 minutes and there's nothing you can do but dump them out.
Yeah.
So that's like a silly waste of time. So getting to the deep root of not just a no, but why, and how we can look to the future or do something else as a compromise, I think is a better approach than just like, no, go to school.
Yeah. And though, you know, their interests get so much more as they get older, right? Like my kid actually like is going to need to go to college. So I really have to look into like, well, I guess that would be good on your resume. Fine, whatever. Yes. So yeah, I like that a lot. And sometimes like you just forget what it's like to be a kid and like what's in their brain about something is so important that you think is so dumb.
It's true.
Pokemon cards, for instance, when my kids were little, I just was like,
yes,
this is the epitome of dumb, but so important to them.
Well, and you know, another good example is my older son, just for his birthday, got an electric guitar. He's been playing guitar for a year. And we told him that after you spend 1 year taking lessons and practicing regularly, we will buy you an electric guitar for your birthday. That's like, you have to earn it and work towards it and show us you want to play guitar. And he did. And he absolutely practiced. I never had to tell him to. He loves it. He was so excited. It was a very big deal. He then went and he's in the school band. And he actually asked, he goes, he asked his band teacher, can I play the electric guitar in the band? And they actually got really excited. But what no one thought about was, how are we going to get the electric guitar and the amp to the school every morning? Because we live in a city and we walk and this thing is heavy. And so that's going to take some parental, you know, help at 7 a.m. when band practice is.
Jamie's going to have to buy a wagon.
Yes, exactly. I was like, what is happening? So, you know, for me, I'm like, oh, this is such a hassle, but it is very important to him and it means something. And like you said, we have to think about college. And so we'll figure out a way to compromise on that and come up with a system. But my instinct was like, oh, are you kidding me? No, but we're going to negotiate and figure out a way to make that work.
Well, and the logical thing there is, yeah, you can do it. You have to get it to school. Like you have to get it to school.
Yes, but he won't be able to carry it all the way. It's really heavy.
A wagon.
Correct. But then, you know, we have to lock up the wagon and yeah, I mean, we're going to have to figure it out. We'll see. But yes, he's going to have a part of it. I mean, I'm not bringing it over there for him. He'll be a part of the process, but you know, we're going to have to help
kids. Okay. What's the next step?
So our next step is setting the climate. I love this. I love this analogy to parenting. This is incredible. So when we set the climate, I actually, like we talked about, I'm really a big fan of collaborative negotiation. It works better. It makes, I think, the person that you're working with, in this case, your kid, feel way more empowered, right? They're like, oh, I have a say. Like, we're going to work together to come to a common ground. And even in those instances, like you're talking about screen time, right? That, I mean, what parent is not fighting screen time every minute of the day? And so we know what's good for our kids. We know what's right for the kids and what their brains need, which is a lot less screen time than their brains crave. And so having a collaborative conversation with them about screen time and instead of, you know, just setting the climate, which is that dictatorship that you're talking about. I mean, that's what I grew up with. I mean, literally, my mom would be like, this is a dictatorship and I'm the dictator. You get no say. And I do have vivid recollections of feeling powerless and angry and frustrated. So instead of making my kids feel like I'm the overlord, which I am, but not making them feel that way, it gives them a sense of wanting to own the conversation and at least having a say in their lives. And so setting the climate, I think, is really very key, assuming one, that an agreement is going to be reached, because I tell all my business clients, like, you have to go into these negotiations assuming you're going to come to an agreement, right? You're a rock star, your business is amazing, and you're absolutely going to make that deal. So I want to think the same thing, like my kids and I can come to a negotiated agreement. So setting the climate, I think, is key. And for parents and for anybody in any negotiation, that's all about listening and all about realizing that the other side has interests, needs, and wants too.
Okay. So it's not yelling. So you're saying screaming and yelling and withholding food is not a climate negotiation?
I mean, maybe withholding food. No. But it's, I mean, I think about it, right? Like, you and I have had many a conversation just about generally my business practice. And I sometimes have to deal with other lawyers and I get screamed at by them regularly because lawyers can often be very difficult humans. And I hate it. It stinks. It makes me feel bad. I don't like to be screamed at. So like, neither do my kids, right? Because nobody wants to be yelled at. So as a reminder that they have very similar feelings, probably, that we do in these situations.
So speaking of lawyers and teenagers, I mean, I get screamed at a lot. You know, for this sure. Isn't fair, blah, blah, blah. So what do you do when the other lawyer's screaming at you? You just keep your happy little Jamie face on?
I do. I actually say to them, I'm really calm. And the more someone yells at me, the calmer I actually get. And I look at them and I say, if you're going to scream at me, and I do actually feel like I'm talking to a child sometimes when I have a lawyer yelling at me, I'll say, please lower your voice. And if you are unable to talk to me without screaming, we're going to have to take this conversation to another time when you're able to control your voice. I swear. This is literally what I say. And so I don't accept it. And I say, please stop yelling. I'm talking to you in a calm voice and I expect you to give me the same courtesy. And if you're not able to stop yelling, then we'll just reschedule this call for another time. And that's kind of what I say to my kids. I'm like, if you're going to yell at me, I'm not going to listen to you. I can't hear you screaming at me. So if you want to lower your voice and have a real conversation where we're going to be heard, I'll do that. So I think in a lot of ways, I kind of talk to my kids like they're an adult and just say, if you want me to not yell at you, then don't yell at me.
Yeah.
So I try not to yell. Sometimes I'm human and they do really boneheaded stuff and I get mad. But for the most part, I really have made a concerted effort, particularly through the pandemic, to not raise my voice because we were all so on edge and so tense and so frustrated that it just adds to that sort of, you're not getting anywhere when you're yelling. Nobody's listening.
I feel like yelling is almost always a reaction. Like, yeah. You know, they break the plate and it's all over the kitchen and they just walk away. Or yeah. It's not so much a negotiation. It's like, why did I have kids?
Yes. When my son accidentally drew on the wall and I'm like, just.
Yeah. It's just a wall.
Breath. He didn't do it on purpose, but I really want to yell at him.
Yeah. Yeah.
He was waving that Sharpie around. Why he had a Sharpie that was being waved around, I don't know, but you know, yeah.
Okay. What's our next step?
We're getting information. So this is where I feel like, I mean, most negotiators fail at this. This is our worst part, is we make a lot of assumptions about what the other side wants. And so when I'm in a negotiation, I'm trying to listen 70 to 75% of the time. And I promise you, as a parent, you're just not doing that. And if you are, you're amazing and should come on this podcast because as parents, we just tend to talk. And so I really believe in the most successful negotiations, I'm just not doing that much talking. I'm listening. I'm hearing what they want. I'm trying to clarify, like, what is my kid actually want? In my Lego example, like, he wasn't going to get anywhere with those Legos. He was just super excited about the new set and he wanted to see what it was about and he just wanted to explore it a little bit. And so hearing him say that, like, oh, I'm super excited about this. I just want to get this done. I mean, sometimes with the screen time, I think it's a perfect example is it's not so much the screen time, but it's the social interaction with their friends, right? All my friends are online and I feel like I'm missing something if I'm not online with them, right? So finding alternate ways, hearing what their need is, right? And then trying to either find another way to get to that need or, you know, or to explain to them or talk to them or figure out a way that we can, you know, come up with a negotiated deal that maybe isn't, 15 hours on their phone, but is something else to get them the need or the interest that they want. So that I think is listening. And sometimes it's a matter of saying to them, yeah, I can't give that to you. Like, you're not going to be able to talk to your friend for the next 7 hours. There's nothing I can do about that. You know, when we were kids, right, we like talked on the phone. And you'd like tie, you know, we didn't have call waiting. So I'm really aging myself here. And so you'd tie up your phone line for 2 hours. And then my grandmother would try to call my mom. And she's like, your phone's been busy for 2 hours. And all I wanted to do is talk to my friend about nothing. I mean, I don't even know what we talked about for 2 hours. It's the same idea.
Yeah.
So it's really listening to them. I think it's getting information and listening, but really listening, not making assumptions about what they may or may not want. And kids, it's way harder with kids, right? They don't often know what they want. And so we have to ask the right questions, those open-ended questions that get them actually talking to us. Because if we actually talk to them, they want you to know what they want. And so I think it's the same with negotiating with any adult. They want you to know what they want so that you can hopefully come to a compromise because then everybody's happy.
Yeah. I love that. You know, especially with teenagers, like it's not so much screen time. Like my one wants to be a animator. So guess what you have to be on? A screen. Yeah. So you just have to figure out like helping him set boundaries and be like, yeah, but your eyes are going to blaze out of your head if you all you do is stare at that screen. So, you know, yeah, hard.
Yeah, we have the same issue. My oldest plays chess and he loves chess. Nobody in the house plays chess, though. And so where is he playing chess? On chess.com. And so I want him to practice that. I want him to have those opportunities, but I can't let him play chess for 4 straight hours. His eyes and brain will frankly melt, despite the fact that playing chess or being an animator is wonderful for their brains. But
yeah,
it's balanced.
So hard.
But then it's teaching them that, right? Helping them understand that difference.
Yeah. And getting to the root of like, what is your actual need? Because his need might be, I need to animate XYZ. I'm like, great, let's get that done let's do it in an hour. Instead of like futzing around to make it absolute perfection. Let's do it in an hour. And then I want your eyeballs to look at something different, you know?
Agreed. Yeah, exactly. So getting that information, asking those questions, not making the assumption that I think sometimes parents, we make the assumption that it's all just kind of nefarious or something dumb or boneheaded, but sometimes they do really have real needs or a real want or something that they actually, you want them to be able to do. So helping them be able to articulate it and listening to them, I think is really key. And frankly, any negotiation, listening is everything.
Yeah. And learning to listen to themselves when they're in college, because then they can be like, okay, what's my actual need here? I know, you know, as a 20-year-old, you'll realize that you can't look at a screen all day, you know, and they can realize, okay, what is my actual need here? And how can I do that while also keeping my eyes? So, yeah.
Exactly.
All right. What's our next step?
So at that point, I think you start to realize the more that you're having these conversations and the more that you're listening, you will start to realize that many of your positions and interests, they're the same. And so once you clarify that and you sort of become more collaborative with them, because, you know, in your situation, you want your kid to be an animator, right? Like you're excited by that. This is a cool thing. And so you're like, yeah, I want that for you too. So let's find a way to have boundaries around that so you can do that. But then you can also like go outside or read a book or, you know, go hang with a friend or whatever the case may be. So clarifying what your aligned interests are is key, because then it takes away a lot of the arguments. It takes away with kids in particular. I mean, in negotiation, hopefully we're not actually arguing. You should be listening and talking and bargaining, I guess you'll say. But you start with this like 1,000 different issues that can be like what you're in, we call them interests and currencies in negotiation. And so sometimes when we figure out what the interests are and how they're aligned, we can move around our currencies, which is the things we're negotiating with, whether it's time, money, you know, alternatives, things like that. Then you're able to come together and say, oh my gosh, you know, hey, child A, we agree on these seven things. There's only this one thing we have to figure out, which for a lot of us, it sounds like it's time. And so let's figure out a way that we can compromise on this time, and we negotiate because we agree on, you know, issues 1 through 7. And then the kid feels like, oh my gosh, I've been heard. So maybe I am more inclined to say, yeah, I get it. It's an hour, or I can only have this, or I got to do this before I can do that. Things like that. Just having that, having them be heard, having them know that there have to be boundaries, and that maybe we can come up with the boundaries together so that they can feel like they have power and control over a life that they don't have power and control over for kids. So that's really clarifying the interests, clarifying the positions, and really figuring out what's left right at the end of all of that. Like, where do we agree? Where are we not quite in agreement yet? And then you know what you need to do because your next step is bargaining.
Yeah. And sometimes I think that's sometimes out of the box. You know, as a business owner, a lot of times that's out of the box. Maybe for a kid, it's like, okay, today you can do chess for 4 hours because that's what you really want to do. But tomorrow we're going to go chess free, you know?
Right.
And negotiating that up front and then making them stick to it probably is the other issue.
Yes.
You got to have a contract. I guess you need a written contract. Call your lawyer. I'm just kidding.
Yes, exactly. We have a planner in our house where we plan out like a written planner so that they know when all their activities are. They know when they're allowed to do the things that we've already negotiated, whether it's screen time, practicing chess, practicing guitar, you know, the fun and exciting things, hanging with their friends, those things. So they know in advance. There's no surprises. And so that I think is also really helpful. And in some ways, it's kind of like a contract because we write the planner out every Sunday night together and they agree to it. They're like, okay, I know I'm doing this on this day. I know I have to do this. Like a great example, my son got a hoverboard for his birthday, which it's just one of the funniest things ever. And he really wanted to ride it, but he had not finished his homework. And I was like, look, man, I said, you got to get your homework done, but I'm not going to let you ride it immediately after your homework is done because you'll rush your homework. So I will, if you can have your homework done and you can do X, Y, and Z, we'll totally go out and get that hover and we'll ride that hoverboard. And so he was like, okay, I understand that. And so he went through and it was much after the time he was done his homework because I didn't want him rushing through his homework. And he was cool with it. And he unfortunately ended up raining. So he couldn't ride the hoverboard. I felt so bad because we had negotiated that deal. And then we looked outside.
God. You did not.
I know. I did not. I mean, God doesn't get included in those things, I think. God does what God's going to do. So yeah, that was unfortunate. But we had to deal with that, right? Like stuff comes up, things happen. And so we figured out another time that we'd fit that in.
When you say we rode the hoverboard, did Jamie get on the hoverboard? Just as a side note?
Yeah, I bought one that could actually hold my weight because the kid ones go up to like, I don't know, like 110 pounds. And I was like, well, that's not working. So I bought the kind that like grownups can go on.
Video, please. All right. Yeah, I think that's super important. So, okay, what's our next step?
So, like you said, we're going to bargain. And the bargaining is usually when we start to argue. I mean, we could have been arguing the entire time, but hopefully by the end of this conversation, because you've had such a long conversation and you've been so collaborative with your kids, hopefully then the bargaining is just a lot easier. And it requires flexibility on the part of the parent. And I think sometimes because we, you know, maybe grew up in the dictatorship model, we forget that we do need to have some kind of flexibility and to give a little. So that does require a give and take to ultimately come to that negotiated deal. And then, like you said, our last step is the contract, which, you know, sometimes it's like our planner and sometimes in business, it's a real contract, which you need. But yeah, writing it down or having an agreement. Sometimes I'll shake hands with my kids if we've come to like a deal and they get a kick out of that. So I think this just memorializing it, just saying, this is what we've agreed to. You agree to it. Don't go back on it kind of thing. And that's the honor system.
And definitely stick to it on your end, right? Because
I mean,
with the skateboarding, like you couldn't, my kids are always like, do you promise? And I'm like, well, I do want to put it, what is it? Force majeure. I want to put a force majeure contract. If I die before the date of this, I cannot promise that
right,
I will
exactly.
XYZ. Or if I'm hospitalized.
If it rains, hoverboard can't go outside.
Right.
Yes, of course, you have to stick with it. That's really key. I mean, you can't go back. You know, the whole notion of because I said so, that kind of stuff, I try to really stay far away from that because, again, it's just, I think a lot of times the yelling, the frustration is just because kids feel powerless. They feel like they don't have a voice. And if we go back on our word, then we're not showing them that they should stick with their word. So I don't break promises unless, like you said, the rain, there's nothing we could do. We were like out there with the hoverboard. We looked up and we're like, oh.
Rain, it ruins everything.
Seriously.
Oh, I was just trying to think about how we could apply this to our friends with toddlers out there. God bless you.
You can't, because that assumes you're negotiating with like a reasonable party.
Yeah. And they have to, and sometimes your toddler is reasonable and sometimes they're not.
Well, I actually think that if your toddler, depending on how old your toddler is, obviously your three, four-year-olds, if they can articulate their needs and wants, I think asking them is really helpful. And I also found that, you know, our instinct is to say no all the time. I mean, I just had this conversation with a friend of mine about just, you know, kids say stuff. You're like, no, no, no. You feel like you're saying no all the time. And in particular, with toddlers, you feel like you're saying no nonstop. So sometimes as a parent, I like to think about like, can I actually say yes to this? So I don't feel like I'm saying no. And if I'm saying no, I try to give a reason, even to a toddler, to help them understand why. Usually it's because of their safety.
Right. Or they're not a hippopotamus.
Right.
Like, right. Just some like random, I want to be a fairy today. Okay. But you can't jump off the roof. Like that's a no.
Don't do that. Yeah. You can't do that. So I try to just give a reason, you know, and see, toddlers are.
Yeah. Well, and something I know, like when you talk about negotiating contracts is like everything could be negotiable. So as a blogger, I can be like, okay, but you only get rights to these photos for 3 months instead of 6 months, or you don't get any rights to photos, or, you know, XYZ. And so, you know, in these complex situations, not just like, I want the red cup and we can't find the red cup. That's just, you just go nuclear at that point. But, you know, these complex, especially as your kids get older, everything in that thing is negotiable. So yes, your curfew is at 10 p.m. But as long as you call me before 10 p.m., we can negotiate that. But I need a phone call to tell me what you're doing and that it's like profitable, whatever you're up to.
Exactly. Yeah, I totally like that. And I like the idea of giving, because kids often don't feel like they get, you know, if you're like in this, you give them a blanket no, and they're like, well, I just got the shaft, you know? So giving, and that's what that is too. There's so many different facets to these issues, whether it's screen time or curfew or, you know, the hoverboard or the Legos, or as complex or as simple as they may be or feel, there's loads of different ways that you can be creative in giving your kid something that they feel like, oh, I actually have a voice. I have a say. This is what will make me happy. You know, there's certain non-negotiables. Like if homework's done, we're not having a conversation. And that's just a rule in our house that they know. So, you know, when they come home and they're like, oh, I didn't finish my homework, I'm like, well, that's a non-starter. So, you know, there are certain things where you have to have rules and boundaries. Obviously, we can't have them running around like crazy people. But once they've met sort of those thresholds, which is like no yelling, get your homework done, pick your stuff up, like the rules of your home, whatever they may be,
right?
There's room for conversation.
Yeah. And I love how you have those basic rules. Like one of our rules at our house is that we don't do overnighters. So our kids can stay out late, they can go to laid-overs, but they don't sleep at somebody else's house just for various reasons. But our kids just know that. Like they know that that's a boundary. And so now the negotiation is, how late can I stay? Can I go over the next morning? All those can I wear my pajamas? You know, all those different kinds of things. So I like that.
Yeah. And every household is their own. So whatever you do, maybe it doesn't work for our family, and that's okay. It's just, you have to decide what those are and clearly communicate them, not assume your kid knows what they are. And obviously they're going to change. You know, when you're toddlers, you don't have to worry about sleepovers, right? Because nobody's sleeping over as a toddler. But when you get into elementary school, that's when those conversations start happening.
Or when you get into high school and the sleepover takes a whole new...
Oh. <Just
kidding. laughs> JK, we aren't there. Well, I mean, maybe we are. Maybe we are. I have no idea. But you know me. I've talked about it to my kids 4,000 times. All right. Jamie, this was awesome. Any last tips you give business owners? I think most of it's just staying calm.
Yes.
And remembering that you both have interests. Because I will say that when you negotiate with a company, they want a great post that does well. And I want to do a great post that does well too. We both have the same interests, really.
That's right. That's exactly right. Like remembering, you know, because in the analogy I often use, particularly like you're using content creators, like oftentimes we feel like David and Goliath. And so in that instance, like your kid feels like David. And so just remember what that feels like. They feel like like, I have no leverage. I have no power. I have no nothing. And I think, you know, remaining calm is really key. And if you're heated, just walk away, much in the same way that I say to those other attorneys, like, if you can't talk to me without yelling, we should probably just make this another day. I've done that with my kids where I'm like, you know what? I'm really angry right now. You said something really boneheaded and I'm going to take 5 minutes.
Yeah. And letting them know that that's okay, that they could take that time out too when I say something mean to them, because rest assured, I've said some mean things to my kids before.
We're human. We do that, right? We can't be perfect.
Yeah. And the pause. We didn't talk about the pause in here, but it's such a good idea. When my manager would like just say so, or I would like drop a bomb, I would just leave it there. The bomb just stays there. The stink stays in the room until they decide to clear it.
That's right. I love it. Yeah. You don't need to explain it. Just say it. Just pause. Let them think about it.
Okay. So many good tips for negotiating with our kids. I think it's so important to remember that they have needs and wants, and maybe I should get that in vinyl lettering in every room in my house, because a lot of times you're just like, no, that's just stupid.
I really, truly try to stop myself from doing that, which is where the pause comes in, right? When they're like, I need this tape and these matches and this piece of paper and 17 toothpicks. And you're like, let me pause for a moment before I'm like, what?
How about you draw me a drawing while I take a pause?
Yeah. I'm like, what's that for? Ask questions.
I saw a meme on TikTok. Was it on TikTok where the kid was like, I need maple syrup and string. And
sounds like my house.
Yeah. I remember those days. Now we do different stupid things, but they just keep bringing in. Somehow they find a new level of stupid every year.
It's true. That's true.
All right. Thanks for coming on, Jamie.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, if you enjoyed that episode, Jamie has one about working from home with kids. We recorded it during quarantine, so I'll put that one in the show notes too. But I really enjoyed that episode just because negotiation really is the same if I'm, you know, negotiating a contract with a company. It's the same if I'm negotiating at my work. And so all of these principles, and negotiation happens in all the things. Like, it happens in PTA. It happens with your kids' teachers. And so when you get good at it, it can be really helpful that you're not feeling it's confrontational. You're just trying to get both parties as much as what they want at a cost they can afford, right? Okay, don't miss next week's episode. We are talking about Christmas, so stay tuned for that one as well. Thanks so much for joining us on today's episode. We know you have lots of options for your ears, and we are glad that you chose us. We drop episodes weekly, and until next time, we hope you have a tangle-free day.